Good day, everyone. Welcome to our new lesson, here the subject, mythology and folklore. For today's lesson, we are about to tackle the quest of the Golden Fleece, or some might know it as Jason and the Argonauts. But before we start our lesson, let me show you our objectives for today. Here are the objectives for today's lesson. At the end of the lesson, 100% of the students with 85 level of proficiency shall be able to, number 1, be aware of the value of myths and folklore in a culture of a place. 2, explain the myths and folklore stories and reflect the culture of a particular place. Last one, recognize political concepts in Roman and Greek legends. Now, let's begin our lesson for today. The history of the story. It figures the tale of the hero Jason and his crew of Argonauts, who set out on a quest for the fleece by order of King Pelias, in order to place Jason rightfully on the throne of Iolcus in Thessaly. Through the help of Medea, they acquire the Golden Fleece. The story is of great antiquity and was current in the time of Homer. It survives in various forms, among which the details vary. Did you know? In Greek mythology, the Golden Fleece is the fleece of the golden-wooled winged ram Chrysomalios, which was held in Colchis. The fleece is a symbol of authority and kingship. For our next topic, the summary of the story. A Greek king, Athamas, gets tired of his wife, Nephele, and puts her to jail. He marries Io, a young princess, in her place. Nephele prays that Io will not kill her two children in order to make Io's own children inherit the kingdom. Io does attempt this murder. However, she secretly gathers seed corn and parches the seed so that no crops will grow. Then when Athamas asks for word from an oracle about how to end the famine, Io bribes a messenger to say that the only way to bring back the crops is to sacrifice his son, Phrixus. Athamas and Io bring the boy to the sacrificial altar, but just before the murder, a wondrous ram with a golden fleece takes the boy and his sister and runs away. The ram, sent by Hermes, is an answer to Nephele's prayers. The ram carries the children across the water from Europe to Asia, and on the way, the girl slips off and drowns. Phrixus arrives safely in the country of Colchis, where he sacrifices the ram and gives it to King Athis. Meanwhile, in another part of Greece, a king named Pelias has stolen the crown from his brother. An oracle tells him that he will die at the hands of a kinsman and that he should be wary of a man wearing only one sandal. One day, a man wearing one sandal comes to town. This is Jason, the king's nephew, come to claim his rightful place as a king. Pelias tells Jason that he would give up the throne if Jason would go out and retrieve the Golden Fleece. Jason sets off and overcomes many obstacles and adventures on the way to Colchis. Finally, with the help of Hera, he reaches King Ephis. Hera and Aphrodite arrange for Cupid to make King Ephis's daughter, Medea, fall in love with Jason. Jason asks Ephis for the fleece, but Ephis says Jason must blow a field of dragon's teeth, which will spring up into a crop of armed men who must be cut down as they advance and attack. Jason agrees, though he believes the task will result in his death. Thanks to Cupid's bow, however, Medea gives Jason a magical potion that gives him invisibility for one day. She also tells him to throw a rock into the middle of the army because it will lead the armed men to kill each other. The next day, Jason proves victorious. The treacherous king will not give him the fleece. However, he plans to kill Jason. Medea helps him again. She leads him to the fleece, charms the serpent guarding it, and flees with Jason back home. On the journey home, Medea tells her brother in the idea that she is protecting Jason. This is the first sign of her madness. When they return to Greece, she arranges for King Pelias to be killed by his own daughters, which fulfills the oracle. Later, Jason marries another woman, and Medea becomes angry that she kills both the bride and her own two sons, fathered by Jason. To further understand the story, here is a short video about the quest of the Golden Fleece.
The Argonautica is one of my favorite epics. This epic has five things going for it. Two of these things it has in common with traditional Greek epic. First, it's full of gods, magic, adventure, and fighting. Second, it offers us a window into the world that produced it. Yet three of my favorite things are completely unique to the Argonautica. The Argonautica has incredibly human characters who respond to the world in a very relatable way. The Argonautica is also blessedly short. It's about a third the size of the Iliad. But the thing that really sets the Argonautica apart from its predecessors is that the Argonautica is a love story. Have you ever noticed that in every movie, be it about aliens, zombies, World War II, or boxing, there's always a love interest involved? Well, that pattern really starts to take off in the West during the Hellenistic period. And in the 3rd century BCE, there was no better place for a new literary form to arise than at the Library of Alexandria, the greatest collection of writing in the world. And at the top of that library was Apollonius of Rhodes, the head librarian. From his lofty perch atop the collected works of Western civilization, Apollonius aspired to match the great Homer and compose an epic for his age. Meet Peleus, the king of Iolcos. Peleus is in a bad position. As an illegitimate son of Poseidon and the former queen, Peleus's reign is on shaky ground. To secure his throne, Peleus has killed, imprisoned, or exiled most of his family. This has angered most of the gods, except, of course, Poseidon. Hera decides Peleus must die. Athena agrees, and the two goddesses set about plotting Peleus's doom. They will use Peleus's cousin, Jason, to destroy the evil king. But rather than just giving Jason a knife and distracting the king, the goddesses plan this whole contrived roundabout way to kill Peleus. Hera doesn't just want Peleus to die, she wants him to die horribly. Jason will go to Colchis, pick up a sorceress named Medea, and bring her home with him. And she will kill the king, in an inventive and awful manner. This may seem crazy to you or I, but Apollonius is simply retelling part of a story that is very, very old. The tale of Jason and Medea. In that tale, Jason retrieves the Golden Fleece from the faraway land of Colchis, with the help of the foreign sorceress Medea. The two marry and make babies. Upon their return, Medea's magical powers attract the attention of King Peleus. Medea tells the king that she can use her magic to restore his youth. This is totally within her power, which she demonstrates by restoring an old goat to youth by submerging it in her magic cauldron. In a particularly sick twist, Medea convinces Peleus' beloved daughters that they must be the ones to perform the magical rite on their father. Yet she gives the girls the wrong potion, and Peleus ends up getting cooked alive by his own daughters. That is the fate that awaits poor King Peleus, cooked alive by his own children. You and I know this. The goddesses know this. In the Hellenistic age, every child knows this. But Peleus doesn't know it. So when a prophet tells Peleus that a man with one sandal will bring about his downfall, Peleus thinks, well, I'll just kill anyone who comes up to me with one sandal. But the gods throw Peleus a curveball. The prophesied one-sandaled man is none other than the king's cousin, Jason. Now, as I mentioned, Peleus has a nasty habit of killing off relatives. But fortunately for Jason, instead of showing up with one sandal at a nice private dining room where he could be disposed of quietly, Jason shows up in public, at the Olympics, no less. Peleus can hardly sentence his cousin to death for a missing sandal in the middle of the Olympics, with the greatest heroes of the Greek world standing on as witnesses. The people wouldn't like it, and the gods are already furious with Peleus. In short, Peleus cannot kill Jason. So instead of killing Jason, Peleus sets Jason an impossible task. Jason must sail to the far-off land of Colchis to retrieve the mythical Golden Fleece. And thus, the goddess's plan is set into motion. Hearing Peleus' challenge, over 50 heroes offer to help Jason in his quest, including Orpheus, the bard whose song could charm even the hounds of hell, and the mighty Heracles, who was well practiced at fulfilling impossible tasks, and even Hylas, Heracles's, let's call him his squire. With this mighty crew of heroes assembled, the goddess Athena helps them build a magical singing boat called the Argo. So decked out, the heroes of the Argo, or Argonauts, set off to Colchis to retrieve the Golden Fleece, with two bloodthirsty goddesses to guide them along their way. On their way there, the Argonauts get into adventures. They impregnate an entire island of women. They lose Heracles when a nymph kidnaps his boy toy, squire, Hylas, and Heracles abandons them to find him. They rescue a prophet named Phineas from a gang of harpies that keep stealing his dinner. Phineas repays them with instructions for their journey. Taking Phineas's advice, the Argonauts stop on the island of Ares, where the birds of Ares shoot their arrow-like feathers at them. On that terrible island, the Argonauts discover a group of shipwrecked sailors from Colchis. Their leader is none other than Prince Argus, grandson of the king of Colchis, Aeetes. Their rescued friends guide the Argonauts to Colchis and give Jason an audience with the king. Meanwhile, on Mount Olympus, Hera and Athena are hatching plans of their own. The goddesses know there is no way Jason can possibly hope to succeed on his own. Jason isn't exactly what one would call hero material. He's not invincible like Achilles, nor clever like Odysseus. Jason's heroic qualities are that he's good-looking and easy to get along with. This has served him well so far. After all, he's attracted a bunch of heroes to help him. But the only person powerful enough to handle what is to come is Heracles, and he's off looking for his boyfriend. Fortunately for the Argonauts, there's a sorceress in Colchis who can help them. Her name is Medea. She is King Aeetes' daughter, princess of Colchis, granddaughter of the sun. Her powers are vast and terrifying. Unfortunately, her loyalties lie elsewhere, and she is unlikely to help the Argonauts of her own will. The two goddesses hatch a plot to get Medea to help Jason with his quest. They visit Aphrodite, the goddess of love. Athena and Hera beg Aphrodite to have her son, Eros, whom we call Cupid, make Medea fall in love with Jason. At this point, you may be wondering, why didn't the goddesses just help Jason themselves? Well, then they couldn't bring back Medea to kill King Peleus. This, of course, raises the question, why don't they just kill King Peleus themselves? All I can say is that Greek gods have a sick sense of humor, and they really enjoy watching people unwittingly destroy themselves through their own actions. In this case, sending his cousin Jason on an impossible quest where he'll pick up a woman who will eventually kill him. Back in Colchis, Jason's meeting with King Aietes is not going well. Something about Jason just makes kings want to kill him in incredibly convoluted ways. Like Peleus, Aietes wants to kill Jason. But instead of just killing Jason, Aietes gives him an impossible task. Jason must harness a team of giant, fire-breathing super bulls to a plow. He then must sow the field of Ares with dragon's teeth. These dragon's teeth will then sprout into full-grown warriors, whom Jason must kill single-handedly. As Jason pales at this incredible demand, Medea has just spotted him across a crowded room. Struck by Cupid's arrow, she falls helplessly in love with him. As a dumbfounded Jason disconsolately returns to his ship, Medea hurries to her bedchamber, full of concern for the beautiful Jason. It is striking that Medea is not portrayed as the monstrous sorceress who will murder King Peleus. Instead, Medea comes across as a love-struck girl, torn between the honor of her family and her powerful love for Jason. There's this beautiful scene where she weighs these two warring passions. In one hand, she holds a potion that will protect Jason during his trial. In the other hand, she holds a potion that will take her own life. Seeing all of her intricate plans on the verge of ruin, Hera fills Medea with a fear of death and love of life, and the maiden finally resolves to help Jason. Using the Prince Argus as an intermediary, Jason and Medea arrange a meeting. Medea meets with Jason in the shrine of Hecate, the goddess of magic. At first sight, Jason realizes that Medea is in love with him, and he pours on the charm, complimenting her, beseeching her aid. Medea is overcome with love for the beautiful Jason. She hands Jason a potion of invincibility, and advises him on how best to defeat the warriors born of the dragon's teeth. Her only request is that Jason remember her fondly when he returns to his home. Now it is Jason's turn to be overcome. He sees Medea's selflessness and beauty and falls in love with her himself. He asks her to return to Greece with him as his bride. The next day, Jason uses Medea's potion, sprinkling it on himself and on his weapons, and an indomitable power enters his limbs. He hurries to the field of Ares to meet Aietes' challenge. There, the huge bulls charge him, their brazen hooves tearing at the earth, their nostrils breathing fire. Jason manhandles the fearsome bulls easily, forcing them to the ground and yoking them to the massive plow. Goading the terrible bulls with his spear, Jason plows the field, planting the dragon's teeth behind him. Releasing the bulls, Jason waits for the warriors to spring up from the earth. He does not have long to wait. Soon hundreds of warriors burst from the ground. Heeding Medea's advice, Jason throws a huge boulder into the midst of the warriors. The earthborn warriors are not very smart, being newly born, and at this shock, they begin killing each other. Jason waits for their numbers to thin a bit, then throws himself into the fray. Soon, Jason is the only one standing on the field of Ares. He has succeeded in his impossible quest. He turns to King Aietes to claim his prize, only to find the king is not there. Aietes is back in his palace, plotting with the Colchian nobility. He knows his daughter has betrayed him, and he plans on including her in his vengeance. Medea is certain her father is on to her. She flees the palace to find Jason and his friends celebrating their victory. Medea warns them that Aietes has no intention of fulfilling his end of the bargain. She begs the Argonauts to flee and take her with them. In exchange, she will help them retrieve the Golden Fleece. Jason once again promises to marry her, and the two set off for the Grove of Ares. There they find the fleece, draped over an oak, and guarded by a massive dragon. Medea casts a spell that puts the dragon to sleep, while Jason snatches the golden fleece from the oak. The two race back to the Argo, leaving the fearsome dragon slumbering behind them. As the Argonauts cast off, Aeetes appears on the crest of a bank at the head of a mighty host. The Argonauts beat out to sea, and the Colchians take to their boats in pursuit. Their flight is cut short by Medea's brother Apsyrtus, and they only escape him through treachery and murder. Medea convinces her brother that all is well, while Jason stabs him in the back. Leaving the Colchians behind, the Argonauts take a very circuitous route. They even leave the Mediterranean briefly to cut across the rivers of Europe. Many aspects of this return journey echo the trials of Odysseus in the Odyssey. The Argonauts visit the island of Circe, who held Odysseus captive. They pass by the Sirens, whose song draws sailors to a watery grave. They avoid this dark fate by having Orpheus outsing the Sirens. They next pass through Scylla and Charybdis, who cost Odysseus so many men. They even make friends with the Phaeacians, the people who carried Odysseus home. At Phaeacia, they are once again confronted by a gang of vengeful Colchians, demanding the return of Medea. However, the king of Phaeacia intervenes. He refuses to separate a man from his wife, so long as the marriage has been consummated. Jason and Medea quickly find a cave and get to consummating, using the golden fleece as their marriage bed, while Orpheus plays them some Barry White. However, the Argonauts aren't just following in Odysseus' footsteps on their homeward journey. They also end up having some original adventures of their very own. They get trapped on the coast of Libya, and nearly end up dying of thirst until a set of local nymphs point them in the right direction. The nymphs give the Argonauts a riddle. You must repay your mother her labor in carrying you in her belly. The Argonauts realize that the mother the nymphs are referring to is none other than their ship, the Argo. They end up carrying the Argo across the desert to a remote lake, but their fate is no better. They wander the lake futilely until finally they're rescued by the god Triton, Poseidon's son, who carries them back to the Mediterranean. Following Triton's directions, they pass Crete. There they face Talos, the man of bronze, whose only delight is throwing boulders at ships that come too near his island. Medea uses her magic to dispatch Talos with a powerful curse. The last thing the Argonauts do is accidentally create the island of Tyra, modern-day Santorini, by throwing a clod of dirt off the prow of the Argo. And just like that, they're home. Suddenly, the Argonautica is over. I guess Apollonius just got tired of writing. This ending is admittedly unsatisfying. But remember, this isn't the end of the story of Jason and Medea. It's only the beginning. We know Jason is going to introduce Medea to King Peleus. We know that Medea is going to ensure that Peleus dies horribly at the hands of his own daughters. The goddesses get their vengeance, and Peleus gets his just deserts. But what happens to our star-crossed lovers? Does Jason become king? Do they live happily ever after? No. It turns out that killing a king is not a great way to endear yourself with that king's people. Jason and Medea flee Iolcus with their children in hand and an angry mob at their heels. They finally find sanctuary in the city of Corinth. Upon their arrival, Jason, realizing that he's married to a murderous madwoman, starts looking for another wife. He finds a potential bride in the princess of Corinth. When Medea finds out that Jason is shopping around, she does not take it well. Jason took from her everyone and everything she loved, only to leave her alone among hostile strangers. Medea decides to return the favor. She kills the princess, making Jason unwelcome in Corinth. But to drive the point home, she also kills her own children, just to deny Jason any comfort in life. Not exactly what one would call a fairy tale ending. Perhaps this is why Apollonius ends his tale so abruptly, before they ever get back to Iolcus. Maybe he wanted to give his readers a happy ending. On the other hand, Apollonius just spent an entire book portraying the monstrous Medea as a lovesick girl, and the unfaithful Jason as a well-meaning but inept hero. Maybe he just wanted to leave his heroic couple heroic, at the height of their glory. So Apollonius brings his account of Jason and Medea to a close, in the last moment of their happiness, with their goal in sight, when all seemed won, and when happily ever after seemed like a real possibility.
For our next one, the setting of the story. Place of action. The main goal of Jason's quest is to reach Colchis, the land of the Golden Fleece. Colchis was an actual historical kingdom with a very long history. The boundaries of ancient cultures are today contained within the borders of Georgia. Time of action. The myths of Jason all take place a super long time ago. Even to the old guys who first wrote down Jason's story, he was a legendary hero from the distant past. Sometimes, the era that Jason and his fellow heroes lived in is called the Heroic Age. Here is a picture showing the land of Colchis. Let's move on to the characters in the story. For our first character, we have Jason. He is a Greek prince of Iolcus whose father has been driven from his throne. Aeson, father of Jason, king of Iolcus. He was overthrown by his half-brother, Pelias. Pelias, the son of Tyro and Poseidon, and thus the half-brother of Jason's father, Aeson. Polymel. She is the queen of Iolcus and the mother of Jason. Medea. The witch, enchantress, or sorceress, and the daughter of King Aetes of Colchis. Eros. Known as Cupid in the Roman mythology, he made Medea fall in love with Jason. Laertes. He participated in the Argonautic expedition, helping Jason retrieve the Golden Fleece from the faraway land of Colchis. Argus. The son of Phrixus was the builder with the help of Athena. The Argo included a beam cut from the divine she of the Donna, which could foretell the future. Chiron, trainer of heroes who also trained Jason. And our last character, Zeus. Zeus was regarded as the bearer of thunder and lightning, rain and wind, and his traditional weapon was the thunderbolt. For our next topic, the themes in the story. Infidelity and inconstancy of men. This happened when King Athamas tires of his first wife, Nephele, and shows her over so that he can marry Princess Io. Had he not done this, the Golden Fleece would have never been created. Moreover, Pelias seizes his uncle's throne, forcing him to kill himself and prompting his wife's death as a result of her grief. Our second theme is trickery of women. Medea betrays her father and murders her brother for her love of Jason. And then, when Jason betrays her, she murders both his new wife and her own children that she had with Jason. Our third theme is perseverance. Jason's quest to fetch the Golden Fleece required some seriousness. For one, he and the Argonauts had to travel a really long way to achieve their goal. This was no kiddie sailing trip. Our fourth theme is exploration. It is important to remember that Jason isn't just famous for being a great hero. He's also thought of as a brave explorer. Part of what makes Jason's quest so not so is that he and the Argonauts are traveling way further than most every other Greek has gone before. For last theme, betrayal and vengeance. It is a classic story of betrayal and vengeance, and like many Greek myths, has a tragic ending. It begins when Jason's uncle Pelias kills Jason's father, the Greek king of Iolcus, and takes his throne. And for our last topic, symbolism in the story. Zetes and Calais. Although these two are members of the Argonauts, just like any other hero that might be in the crew, these two resemble something more than just their backgrounds. As two sons of the North Wind, it symbolizes that the gods favor Jason on his mission and will help them in various ways. For an example, later on his quest, Zeus sends a favorable wind that blew them away from the land of Amazons, the land of the warrior women, so that they could avoid trouble that they did not seek for. And that's it for our today's lesson. I hope that you gained more knowledge from our topic today. Thank you for listening!